So my name is Daniel Kelly. I am the lead instructor at Vue School. Very happy to be with all of you today. Let's get to the topic at hand, and that is patterns for large-scale Vue.js applications. All right, so today I want to answer the question, what is the best way to structure a Vue.js app so that it remains maintainable and maybe even more importantly, in my eyes, a pleasure to work on the larger it gets, right? Why is this important? Because I guarantee you, every single one of us in this room at one point or another has felt exactly like this little girl, right? They've got the issue, they've gotten the task for a bug fix or a new feature add, and they have no idea where to start. And it's not because of the complexity of the ask, it's because your code base is a mess, okay? All right, I've been there, I'm not blaming you. All right, so I'm going to share with you 7 tips for building these maintainable large-scale apps. Starting with tip number 1, this one is not exciting, it's not flashy, it's not fancy, but it's true. The number 1 thing for a scalable app is make it predictable. Make it predictable. As mentioned a moment ago, I like to do a little woodworking. Honestly, don't do it enough. Computers take too much of my time. But when I do get to do it, one of the things you learn very quickly about the world, the modern world that we live in, is it is so standardized. Our lives are so easy. Because when you're working with a piece of wood and you got to cut it the exact right size, it's not easy. You may think it's easy to cut a straight line. It's not. You have to get things down to so close, right? But the reason the modern world we live in works is because of standards, okay? My sheets fit my bed because of standards. My plug fits the wall because of standards. This is what makes the modern world go around, and this is what's going to make your code base easier to maintain, okay? So that begs the question, what are the standards that are available for the Vue.js community? Well, the number one place for those standards that I can think of is the Vue.js style guide. This is found on the official website, right? It comes with a number of different standards so that your app can be predictable. People who have never opened your code base before can follow these standards and they can immediately jump in your app and know what things are what, or at least to a certain degree, right? So just as a sampling of some of those standards, here's what that style guide says about components. Okay, it mentions that components should be Pascal case. It says that we should prefix our base components, those app level components that are meant to be reusable everywhere. We should prefix those with app or base, okay? It also mentions that these should be multi-worded names, and this is actually more than just a stylistic rule. This actually helps prevent conflicts between future or existing HTML elements, okay? This is just a little sampling some of the standards provided there. There's a lot of others for both components and other portions of your Vue app, but the idea is if there's a standard, use it. It's going to make your app more predictable, and when you use conventions, new and existing team members are going to have to think less about your code base, and they're going to get to business, okay? Just a quick note here, there is this little warning at the top of this style guide currently that it is a bit out of date because of the composition API, and this was written more in the era of the options API, but there's still a lot of rules there that apply to your projects, your V3 projects now, okay? Another great source of standards is the officially recommended tooling for Vue.js. This is things like Vite for your build tool, things like Pina for global state management. And you may be thinking right now, Daniel, okay, that's a little like, duh, okay, I should be using these things. But let me tell you, I guarantee you, at least every other conference I visit, and some of the other people who attend a lot of conferences here can probably attest to this, you always have that one person who comes up to you and says, I built my own global state management solution. I built my own router, right? And I think, you know, that's really cool because I've done the same thing and it was a disaster, right? So a little story, back before Pina, there was UX, right? I hated UX mutations. Totally confessed that. So I said, okay, I can do it better. And I tried, and I put it into a production product, and it caused so many problems, right? Number one, not only did I have to explain this system to every new person that came onto the project, while if I had just used Vue.x, they would have already known, right? But I also came across performance issues because I didn't take into account some of the caching things that Vue.x was doing under the hood, okay? So the point is if there's an available solution, and especially if it's recommended by the official documentation, use that. Don't go off and do your own thing unless you have a really good reason to. All right. A really great source for predictability and for standards is also Nux3. This is a huge part of our community at this point. And you'll see Nux3 throughout the rest of this presentation. I won't dive too deeply into this. But suffice it to say, at this point, whenever I start a new project, I don't ever type in npm init vue anymore. I type npx nux init, be perfectly honest, because there's so many standards there that I don't have to recreate in a vue project, a vanilla vue project. All right, so tip number two is take full advantage of your IDE. This is the tool we're all in every day. Why not make the best of it? Okay, the first way you can do that is, of course, by installing Volar. If you're still got Vitor installed, uninstall that sucker, get Volar installed, easy win, okay? But the next thing is make sure you have linting set up, okay? This is going to ensure that you catch errors before your code ever even hits the browser. This may seem basic, it may seem simplistic to some of you, but I've worked on projects where we didn't have this. Maybe that was my fault, but you need to set this stuff up, okay? It's going to show you errors that could potentially cause issues in the future, like there on line 3. This is not going to warn you in the console, in the browser. There's technically no error here, but there's a best practice that's being violated, right? Anybody know what it is? Shout it out. Keys missing. Exactly. And as soon as that list item has its own state to keep up with, we've got an issue, right? If there's a reordering. Okay, so also there on line 12, what's wrong? Unused component. I would not have caught that if I didn't have that little red squiggly line. I'm moving too fast, right? I'm getting stuff done. This helped me stop and think. All right, formatting. Make sure your IDEs are set up to use Prettier, ESLint, whatever it is for formatting, automatically on save. It's 2023, y'all. Don't be doing this yourself. Who cares if it's spaces or tab, right? Let your IDE do it for you. So we have a course at Vue School all about using Visual Studio Code for Vue.js development. We have a lot of tips and tricks, just like the ones I've just shared with you. If you want to optimize your IDE experience for Vue, then definitely check this out. Okay, we talk about Vue snippets, we talk about working with Git, and a lot more. Lastly, in order to get the most out of your IDE, some of you are going to like this. Some of you are going to be like, ooh, yeah. Okay, use TypeScript. If you're building a large-scale app, if you're expecting your app to grow to be what you could call a large-scale app, and you haven't decided to use TypeScript yet, you really need to step back and reconsider that, okay? TypeScript is going to provide a ton of safety for you. It's going to prevent errors as you're developing. It's going to reveal things directly in your IDE that sometimes you wouldn't have caught without, or you would have had to wait to run it in the browser, right? This is the biggest one. This is the biggest one. It makes your refactors less stressful and less risky. You all have been there and you know it just as much as I do. Business needs what? Change, right? They change. Your app is going to have to be refactorable. A scalable app is a refactorable app. TypeScript's going to help you a ton with that, okay? And it also gives your autocomplete superpowers. We also have a course at Vue School all about TypeScript with Vue.js, so check that out as well if you're new to TypeScript. By the way, I told you I was going to shout out the Nux a few times. Nux has TypeScript enabled by default, and if you're a newbie to TypeScript, definitely check out Nux. It's a great way to dabble. You could do JS files all over the place and then do a single TypeScript file and then just play with it and learn and get into it. And then do another TypeScript file. And then you feel, oh yeah, that feels nice. And you do another TypeScript one, right? You add lang equals TF, get a little crazy on some of those Vue components, okay? It's a great way to introduce yourself to TypeScript. Okay? Nuts even auto-generates some of these types on the fly for you. So if you're making a request to an API endpoint that you've defined in Nuts, we get this nice little user select dropdown here when we're typing. Really great. And by the way, we also get the return, the response from those API endpoints automatically typed for us. If you want to take it one step further, you could even get complete end-to-end typing with tRPC. That is your request and your response. Okay, so number three is all about file structure. It's inevitable when you talk about large-scale patterns, someone asks, what about file structure? Well, I used to have a long spiel. Now my spiel is use Nuxt. Okay, it has great conventions baked into it that are already community-wide, and it builds magic on top of those conventions, right? So we have components in the components directory that are auto-imported for you. We have composables that are auto-imported, pages that are automatically turned into routes. It's really magic, and it helps you think less about the details and think more about the important things for your business. Okay? I do like to stray from this just slightly. So this is just my recommendation. You don't have to follow it, but I do like to group page-specific components with the actual pages that they're being used on. So if there are components that are only used on a specific page, I throw that in a partials directory along with the pages that they're used on. Okay? That's just my one little anti-convention. I had to share it. This actually even allows me to view these page components in isolation because there's a route auto-generated for them. Sometimes this is useful. Sometimes that component relies on data from the page, so it's not actually useful. But yeah, give and take. Lastly, of course, you can remove these at build time. If you're interested in the snippet to remove these things so they don't have a route automatically made for them, I'm at DanielKellyIO on Twitter. I'd be happy to share that snippet with you, okay? So tip number four here is have a route naming convention in your apps. There's a little something called resources that all of us have in our apps. Let's face it, your app's not that unique, okay? We've all done a lot of these things before. I'm just kidding, y'all. A lot of y'all are building some really cool things, but all of them have commonalities, and resources are one of them. What do I mean by resources? I mean tables in your database, essentially, right? Posts, comments, users, and they all have to be created, read, updated, and deleted. Well, have your routes reflect that, okay? I come from a Laravel background, and so I steal this, and it works great. I didn't have to think about it. I stole it, and I use it. Okay, so this is routes for our front-end pages that correlate directly to those create, read, update, delete functions. And these are also API endpoints. Once again, not going to dive deeply into these. Go check out the Laravel documentation. You can steal this in Nuxt. It might look something like this. Okay, the edit one is a little bit different just because I like to change it for keeping it in the same file structure. But the point is, have a route convention. You don't have to use this one, but have a route convention in place that your whole team can follow. Okay, tip number five is to wrap third-party code. Sometimes. Not all the time, but sometimes. Why? Well, because this decreases our chance of third-party lock-in, and it also helps increase the surface area for app-specific optimizations. Don't know what that means? Okay, let me share with you an example. Let's say we have Axios as a dependency of our app, okay? By the way, I don't recommend wrapping Axios. This is just a good dependency that everybody's familiar with, okay? So let's say we have Axios making our AJAX request. Well, we could wrap Axios in, let's say, an HTTP class. Ooh, I'm proud of myself. I didn't say HTTP because I always suck at that. All right, so let's say we have an HTTP class. And all it does is wrap Axios, right? Well, if for some reason someday we can't use Axios anymore, all we have to do is replace it with fetch in that one single file, right? Yeah, you probably have to do a little transforming or something before you send it out of the function, but you're only updating things in one file. And in fact, the other developers that are working on your application that are using this class throughout the app, they never even have to know that the dependency changed, right? This is beautiful. So this is great for dependencies that are a little wishy-washy, things that can change in price, things that are in beta, things that you might want to change out in the future, right? And you can also easily extend functionality this way. So let's say you wanted to handle all the errors in your application the same way, all the errors went for your AJAX request in the same way. Well, you could put that in one single place, right? Don't use an alert, don't do this, but you get the idea, okay? Or maybe some kind of caching. By the way, this works for components too. All right, tip number six, and I know everybody's getting hungry, so we're getting there. Tip number six is interact with your backends via an SDK. Shout out to me. Let's do this. Raise your hand. Who would rather write line number one here? Raise your hand. We have one. Love you. All right. It's honest. That's great. That's great. Who would rather have number two? Okay. Some people aren't making AJAX requests. some people are not raising their hand at all. Awesome. But here is why I would prefer number two. Okay. Is number one, it helps prevent typos. Number two, it provides you the opportunity to do some client-side data normalization before you ever take that stuff to the app layer, right? So this is things like changing your dates that come from the backend from strings to actual date objects. And that's just a simple example, right? It's also easier to spot errors and provide type safety this way. By the way, you don't have to write these SDKs yourself. A lot of backends as a service provide these JavaScript SDKs for you. Things like Firebase, which, by the way, we use in the Vue.js 3 masterclass at Vue School. Things like Supabase. This is my new favorite backend in the world. This is a wonderful tool, okay? And by the way, you can even generate types based on your database schema with Supabase with this one simple command, okay? So automatically, I've got type safety from my database layer all the way down to my front end. For those Laravel people out there, Laravel Query Builder also has a great JavaScript SDK to go with it as well. All right, last and final tip is prefer the composition API. Prefer the composition API over the options API. Why? Not just because it's the newest and shiniest, but because it's easier to spot opportunities for abstraction and code reuse. It's just easier to see. When you have all that logic there grouped together for one particular logical concern, it's a lot easier to take that little chunk and move it to an external file, to a composable, than it is to see all the different disparate options in your options API and take those different things and move it into a mix-up. Not to mention all the other problems you have with mix-up, right? Prefer the composition API because it's going to help you see the abstractions more clearly and help you reuse code more easily. All right, so in summary, number one, use standards for predictability. Number two, take advantage of your IDE. Three, use nuts for a standardized file structure. Adopt a route naming convention. Wrap some third-party code. Interact with backends via an SDK. And finally, prefer the composition API over the options API. I am Daniel Kelly with Vue School. Thank you so very much for your time. Enjoy your lunch.